Becoming the Man, Chapter 7, The Job Opening. They offered him six figures, guaranteed to start. They offered him housing. They threw in a company car. They spoke of a top security clearance with the United States government. They told him he would be the first African American to have ever held the position since it was created. "How did you get this number, if you don't mind me asking? I don't recall sending a resume to the government," Paul said slowly. The man on the other line replied, "We only recruit the finest, the smartest, and the brightest, and according to the people at Howard University, that is you, son." Paul couldn't help but beam with pride. By this time, he had a pen in his hand, jotting down notes as fast as he could, while his wife Tricia looked on, bouncing in excitement. She could tell by the way his pen scrawled feverishly it had to be related to a job interview. "All right, 9 a.m. on Monday it is. I'll be there." Monday came and it was 10:45 a.m. Paul had arrived early at 8:30, filled out his confidentiality agreements, and he was 1 hour into an interview slash conversation with the higher-ups. He felt like he might throw up the organic eggs he ate for breakfast. He sweat through the tailor-made suit he wore to every job interview. He was dizzy, and the room spun as the higher-ups described the job. He thought it had to be a dream, and at one point felt as though Satan himself was offering him money for his soul. These people were asking him to take large sums of money to hold the black race back in America. He knew that to have even been offered such a position, his very life was at risk. In one short hour, he heard more than he wanted to know. "You mean to tell me there's a government position where you implement policies to specifically keep a certain level of despair in the black community to obtain a balance in American society? And on top of that, you're asking me, a black man, to fill this position?" Paul Roberts unbelievingly asked. The first higher-up replied, "Not only are we telling you that, we felt as though you as a person were special enough to be told that. Because trust us, the president isn't too sure we exist. Now, we don't want you purposely hurting your own people. It doesn't really work like that anymore. You have to think globally about the balance of the markets and resources." The second higher-up quickly added, "You know what? Everything he says to clean it up is fine, and yes, I agree. But how about this? I have a plastic card here with some numbers on it. The owner of this card will have access to $1 million. Just like that, right away. Just to think about the position. How the fuck do you like them apples, Paul?" "Yes, we do fucked up shit here at the government, but we get paid really fucking well. How much do you get paid, Paul?" "Well, my friend, here's $1 million. Just for even walking in this office and not saying shit should you walk out this office and turn down the opportunity of a lifetime. Go buy a brand new house, Paul. Pay for it with cash. Because I know what you're thinking, Paul. You're thinking this can't be real. And how did I get caught up in this shit on a Monday morning, 1 hour into a job interview? Well, guess what? That's where we're at right now. So I want you to go home, think about the job, hit any ATM after 5 p.m., and you tell me if this is a joke or if this is the job for you." Paul Roberts sat flabbergasted. He had no rebuttal. This had to be a cruel joke played by his old college buddies. He relaxed, and the strength came back to his hips and knees. He smirked a little, thinking that even for 1 minute he believed this was a real job interview. Now in on the joke and playing along, Paul stood up and said, "Thank you, gentlemen. I will consider your proposal. Now slide me that card. It might get expensive keeping these Negroes in line." He grabbed the card, rolled his eyes, left the office, and felt silly for wasting his own time and missing a day's work at the community center. "I have a feeling we will be seeing more of him," the second higher-up added. "I don't know. The more I think of it, wouldn't it just be easier to get a white guy or maybe ease into it with a Hispanic?" countered the first higher-up. The second higher-up replied, "It has to be a black man. I know we can do this."